I am the co-curator of the exhibition Shadow Scenes as part of this year's Cinnamon Columboscope, which is taking place at the Rio Complex. Some of you have been there, but I'd like to tell you a little bit about this exhibition, just to contextualize as well the practices that we are going to discuss today. We're going to have with us the four artists, three of whom are from across Europe, and we have among the local artists, we have Liz Fernando, who is currently based in Colombo. So Shadow Scenes is an exhibition that has taken place in a circumstance which I find quite unique. We've been presented with this building that has a very specific legacy and a sort of public memory that we are at this point collectively experiencing and relating to. The Rio Complex as a cinema and hotel, an abandoned hotel that is in a sense of destruction, but also is constantly manifesting new perspectives for us on what this city could possibly be as a sort of projection site, or also taking us back to then the darker past of 1983, Black July, and how that forecasted a dark period in Sri Lankan history. So there are various ways in which the artists, over 50 artists from across the country and internationally, have responded to this site. A lot of works embed themselves into each hotel room as personal trajectories, as interior worlds, as systems that contest this kind of logic of terror, but also the potential of cinema, of telling stories, of imagining possible scenarios in which there might be a fictional character, or in which the city itself might manifest as a plot that involves sculpture, sound, film, and painting. We don't know the future of this particular site, which also makes it very, very volatile to work within it, to, in a way, build it up from its state of abandonment into a site that we've occupied together during this installation period, and now through the public coming back into this site since it was looted and put onto fire. And now, again, it continues as a cinema, which makes it very interesting for the artists who we are speaking with today, who deal with the materiality of cinema, the forms in which photography can expand into sculpture, into books, and into various kinds of installation forms. So I'm now going to briefly introduce each of the artists, and then they will spend a few minutes discussing their work within Shadow Scenes and also their recent practices. I will start with Alexandra Navratil, who joins us from Amsterdam, but also takes up a teaching position that often results in travel to Basel for her. Alexandra draws from the territory of archival imagery, the history of cinema, and its role in representation of truth. She also deals with projections of possible phantom narratives looked at through the intricacies of cinematic materials. The works result in installation, sculpture, and print-based work, often labor-intensive and process-oriented. Alexandra was awarded the Swiss Art Award and followed by the Manor Prize in 2013. She's had shows in Berlin at Dan Gunn, also at the Stedelijk Bureau Amsterdam, at a group exhibition in the Appel in Amsterdam, at the Kunstmuseum Winterthur. One of the speakers, Agnieszka Polska, Polish artist, unable to join us today. We have next to Alexandra Lucy Scare, who comes from Glasgow. Lucy works with sculptural, filmic, and paper-based works and brings together the role of perception as a conceptual device and the staging of materials through acts of historical reinterpretation, as well as the movement of images. often the formations between the real and the likeness, as well as a sublime approach to found objects, is seen and staged in her works. Lucy has shown at the gallery, Fruit Market Gallery, Edinburgh, and in Kunsthalle Basel. She's also been nominated for the Turner Prize in 2009. Liz Fernando, who most of you would know, is a photographer and an artist. She's trained in London in photography. She recently had an exhibition at the Red Dot Gallery in Tirtha, where she made a new body of works called The Imprint of Lovers, which she will discuss briefly with us today. Also, she is teaching at the Raffles Institute here in Colombo, and her work has been shown at the Tate Modern and is part of the World Bank collection. Susanna Winterling joins us from Berlin. She is also a professor at the Fine Arts Academy in Oslo. Susanna is trained in philosophy and art history. She is very much interested in feminist practices from modernism, looking at architecture, say from Eileen Gray, but also modernist travelers, journalists such as Anna-Marie Schwarzenbach, and figures such as her. She works with 16mm film, sculpture, print-based works, again, very much looking at film and photography as a sentient medium, as a bodily condition, as a performative state. So I will now, after these introduction rounds, allow the artists to take over, and we have a set of images accompanying each artist so that you have a view into their works.
Yeah, that's me. Can you change to the next, please? So I'm quickly going to talk about the work that's in the Shadow Scenes show that maybe you have seen. It's on the fifth floor, I think, fourth floor? I'm not sure. This is the work consists of a video and the print works that I've done recently for this show on purpose. And the works derive from a longer research that I've been conducting since 2013 when I did a residency in Berlin. And I became interested in the history of Agfa. Agfa is the kind of German film company that produced films and photography material. And so I began researching in this area, which is like about 1 hour from Berlin, called Wolfenbitterfeld, and that's a former industrial area where the Agfa company was based. And so from this kind of archival research, several works derived, and the last one was now this one called Silbersee, Silver Lake, basically. And so I was looking into the components of filmic emulsion, basically. So I did one film about gelatin, the gelatin component of film. And this one somehow was a speculation on the silver crystals that make the analog filmic image. And then kind of while conducting the research, I came across this lake, which is called Silbersee, Silver Lake, which by 1990, when there was the German reunification, was the most contaminated lake in the whole of Germany. And it used to be a coal mine fueling the industrial revolution in the area. But then all the industries were kind of putting their wastewaters into this lake. So it became really this kind of extremely contaminated place. And so what I used for this work was archive of a person I met. He's a chemist that used to work in the DDR for Agfa. And he allowed me to use his archive. So basically what happened, he became, he started working for Agfa in order to search for a replacement of the silver component, because it was such an expensive material. And he had a personal crisis when he started working for the company and started obsessively photographing the lake, because somehow he held the lake responsible for his crisis. And so he allowed me to use his archive, his personal archive of about, I don't know, he had like hundreds of images that he kept on taking of the lake over the years. And so, okay, now it's moved on to the next. So from this video, then I also kind of wanted to make print works, which are kind of, you see there, it's this nature elements that are mapped with the silver crystals. So it's this idea that what if the silver components and the emulsion of the film factory seeps into the landscape and turns the whole landscape into a photosensitive land in a way. So kind of the landscape becoming the photographic plate in a way. So it comes from that. And maybe more general, already in 2011, I started a broader research which engages with the emergence of the organic chemical industry and kind of the turn from natural materials to synthetic materials, and so also the invention of film, filmic materials, synthetic colors, and so kind of all these works kind of derive from this, yeah, from this thing. Yeah, this is a work. It's basically I took film strips from archives. This is from the film archive from Amsterdam, and I was looking for cloud formations, showing kind of industrial clouds of productions or destruction, or and the end product then became a weaving. So it's like, this is a close-up, but they're like this 7-meter-long weavings, kind of the film strip transformed into weaving. So there is always this transformation of materiality or, yeah, of kind of surfaces. Yeah, that's a bit hard to see. These are three film strips from, they're also from the film archive in Amsterdam, but they were commissioned by the Colonial Institute around 1910. And they show phantom rides, which are kind of train rides into the landscape, kind of to show the progress of the colonies. And so what I took is also kind of, I took them and I laid them out in strips. And then you have enlargement, how you say? Yeah, magnifying glasses, kind of magnifying certain parts. And it was this idea that, like, you know, kind of the kind of the phantoms, the people on the margins of the film that just sip by and kind of never get any attention. They're kind of enlarged and taken out, and these are the ones that the people who constructed the rails, basically, that allowed these films to be made. So it's kind of this kind of taking out a moment of the actual film strip that made this work. Yeah. Now maybe I jumped now a bit around, but yeah. I mean, in general, I can summarize it, I can say I'm interested in film and its materiality, and yeah, kind of maybe also material that has not been really looked at, like industrial films or yeah, more like images from the margins that I re-examine, and I take these archival images and I somehow bring them back to life. I reanimate them back to life by giving them a new reading or a new meaning. So, maybe, yeah.
Hi, I'm Lucy Scare, and I've also made a work that very much centers on the materiality of film, so I think there's a lot of overlap between our projects in some ways. My project that I'm showing here is a stage in an evolution of a project that began in 2012. It started with this work, which is called Film for an Abandoned Projector. And the project was really to find a projector somewhere that was not in use and make a film specifically for that projector. So the projector could be in storage, or it could be in a junkyard, or it could be in a building that was previously a cinema, which is where I found it, actually. And because the projectors, 35 millimeter projectors, are so big and so heavy, A lot of them weren't removed from cinemas when the cinemas were closed and repurposed to be, in this case, a light bulb factory and then a church. It's currently a church, this building. Oh, a bit louder. Okay, sorry. So we found the projectors and then we renovated them. And I imagined what the psychology of the projector would be, which is kind of a ridiculous projection on my part. But I wanted to keep the idea of all of the images that had come out of this projector into this room and then try to imagine what the projector would most like or most crave. So I got a film camera, which I fixed up myself, and then I went on a kind of tour of around the UK to try to find these different images. And I shot all of the film myself. And it was all shot during the period of the month of July, which is where the title of the work that I'm showing here comes from, which is called Margin of July. After I'd finished this project in the cinema, which was in Leeds, I wanted to extend the work into a narrative of its own so that I would never show the work on a different projector, because it was made for this one specific projector. So the next time that I showed the work, I removed all of the images from the film, just leaving the margin of the film left. So I made a tool that could punch out each of the frames. So the film still plays, but just in the very edge of the image. And in the Rio, I'm showing the print that was shown in the original cinema with the center punched out, and that gives a white center to the screen. And then the negative also punched out, which gives the black center to the screen. And I wanted to kind of separate the actual pictures out and make them into a physical presence in the room. So the doorway is partly blocked up by resin that has all of the film frames in it, embedded in it. So that's the kind of evolution of that project, and it's quite typical of some of the works that I've been making in the last 5 years that refuse to be single works, because often if you're an artist, you show a single work and then it moves to another venue or another gallery and you show it again as the same work. And I've been trying to resist that happening by making the work into a narrative and sometimes melting it down and casting it again to suit a different space, so it becomes a kind of story of its own. Maybe we can go to the next work. This is also a work that has a tension between abstraction and representation, and in some ways narrative. It's a chain of sculptures, and each one is a copy of the one before. So the original sculpture is the one closest to here, and it's made from mahogany slices. And then the one behind it is a copy in ceramics. And the next one is a copy in aluminium of the ceramics, and then in marble, and then in wood again. So it's like each copy is made one-to-one by a different artisan or maker, and they don't work from photographs or from drawings, they just work from the object before. So the previous object goes to their workshop, and then they copy it over, and then the next one goes to the next maker, and they again copy it. So there are a lot of mistakes that happen or damage that gets done while they're moving around, and that gets incorporated into this chain of sculptures. And it's quite consciously like not a very contemporary way of working. It's a very it is a pre-modern way of working. It's a kind of archaic way of making things that I find kind of interesting. Okay.
Hi, my name is Lisonando. Some of you maybe louder have maybe met me before or talked to me before. So my work is.
I think your mic's not on. Actually.
It's not.
Oh, so maybe you should think. Yes, maybe.
Is it better? Yeah, no, it's on. Okay, Luis Fernando is my name. One of my first works which I did, and you heard Lucy and Alexander speaking about materiality of film and how I think we are kind of researching the archiving process behind it and how we are working it. So my personal perspective towards photography or the archiving element of it is while studying in London and having my heritage here in Sri Lanka is that I was faced with the problem of not having a photographic narrative, not having visuals of my ancestors and things like this. So what I did is this book, which is called Trincomalee, My Father's Stories and the Lost Photographs, is a journey through my childhood and my father's childhood, which is kind of going on the line of the existence of photographs and the existence of photographs and how it's influencing the human memory. So what I did is I went to this place and tried to stage the childhood or the memories which are not existing and which kind of somehow maybe declined during the years, or maybe the photographs never existed. So this is what I was doing with this project, and it ended up in a photo book, a book form. So what is the case for my work is I always work with like different mediums of exhibiting this. So this time it was a book because I felt it was a journey which I wanted the viewer or the reader be part of. It was a journey through a lot of white and blank spaces because of the impossibility to visually archive it. So this work is about that. It is 13 photographs based on that narrative, going to the place, going to Trincomalee, and finding whatever is missing in my memory, in my visual memory. Moving on to my most recent work, which is again based more or less on the understanding of how I visually archive memories or moments. This is called The Imprint of Lovers, which was exhibited in London and most recently here at Theatre Red Dot Gallery. It works with spaces. It works with kind of spaces where lovers leave or where lovers take their memories from, random hotel rooms, random places where they would go to meet and be intimate with each other. And so I've been to these places, tried to get a little bit of anatomy of these rooms, and I have exhibited this in a bit of an abstract way. So I'm talking about the absence and presence and kind of what would we leave there, what is not able for, what are we not able to take with us, though we are leaving a lot of us there. So that's The Imprint of Lovers. What more can I say moving towards this work which I've produced now for Columbus Scope? It is a site-specific installation. And now if you're kind of getting a feeling, so I have a book, I worked on a book, now then another one was prints, and this one is a photographic installation working on the ancient theory of optics, which are kind of the background of people who work with photography, video. We work with how actually light works, so we are depending on light, and this installation I have created a room which is kind of a pinhole camera. So it's kind of, we are walking into a black box of a camera. And what we'll see on the wall is the projected image of the outside scenery, which we can finally also see on this background here. So it's, I think, exactly this one, which is projected on there. So it's a natural projection just using sunlight. And it's the old theory of the camera obscura, which I have been applying on this. And it's site-specific in the sense my room is located not in the hotel complex, it's located just above the cinema. So if it's really silent in there, I can hear during the screening hours, I can hear the movie, I can hear the residents of the movie. So through a little bit of research and talking to people, I was actually interested in the very like personal memory of the space, and I collected a lot of memories from people who have very romantic memories of that place, being one of the first, like, it was, I think, for Sri Lanka, the first 70mm cinema, and it the premiere film was called South Pacific, which was a Roger Hammerstein movie, like, it goes with like this Mary Poppins, and the other one was Sound of Music. So these were the films which were screened there, which is not really, I couldn't really imagine that something like this was screened, because we, of course, like, explore this place in a different way. So I have used texts of these movies, and these texts are running through and on that projection itself. So I'm juxtaposing that changing cityscape, which I see there, with what I feel is being kind of, we are being in there, like, it's like kind of a time capsule which I'm entering when I'm in this room. So these kind of things working together, it's a bit, it's a bit cinematic what is happening there, because, as I said, located just above the cinema, I felt I should work with these kind of texts. And you can see when you're inside that room, the crows are flying on that screen. So it's projected reality, and it engages with the idea of what happens when we sit in a cinema and when we watch what is actually not reality. So it's running on the line of two realities which are happening there. So I have a cinematic one and the mirrored reality from the outside. So that is what I have been doing with this project, which is called I Need Darkness to See Light.
Right. Well, maybe I'd take that one.
Right.
Hopefully, yes. Hello, everybody. My name is Susanne. And yes, so much about the materiality of film has already been said. It's also one over umbrella of what I'm interested in, but I would also add or maybe specify that I'm interested in the ping pong between subjectivity, technology, and materiality of film, and also maybe bringing in the word photograph when you see a film, like what is actually happening to you as this person coming in. And of course, I work, like I guess most of us here, with decomposed or parts of what is film in its substance. So I like to work a lot with plexi and acrylic glass, because the early compositional parts, and also because of the qualities of the shiny surface that is basically reflecting the surrounding and reflecting your body and the body that goes in it, the body that's on the screen and the body that's watching the body on the screen. The work for that is shown in the Rio Cinema is taking up on that. It's a work called My Physicality. It's basically the blue screen photographed, actually analog photographed and then digital, and maybe that's a point that I can bring in here as a new feature. I'm interested in the materiality of film, not only in the past and in the archive, but also in contemporary image culture, image industry, like the all the, let's say, digital image making. I work with animation, computer generated images. They all rely on a materiality. They rely heavily on a labor force of still very human elements, and they rely on cables, they rely on resources, they rely on what is creating the electricity. So I'm interested in all these elements, and I also do see this as a gap or as a problem of denying the singularity and only going to the universal, which I think is like a political aspect, which I found interesting in the Rio cinema, because the whole context or the whole ecology of the surrounding environment seems to be so much like getting prepared for a future breakdown, knockdown, and there is like a lot of there are a lot of stories around, even if I don't know them, and I don't know the stories of all the people who live around or who have been in Slave Island. I think like the air, the whole building is full of these stories. And I think it's also cinema itself that has this as a potential of carrying all these stories in the ones that are reproduced, but also the ones that we add as the single body seeing the film, connect with them and make our own film while we're watching the film. Did I space off? I'm sorry. But so it connects to the other work, which is maybe a little bit the technology aspect, but in a nostalgic way, because the record player also creates each time it's played a more singular hearing, listening experience than digital devices do. Or I think there's also a lot of electronic musicians or artists kind of hunting after this, the always new experience of listening. And how do you create that in like a long time after Walter Benjamin's seriality of the image or the listening? And I think like in listening and in the smell, this is like maybe the easiest pressures, because we all know that what we smell now will maybe be very different, even if it's created by the same flower or by the same disgust. It's like the way that we smell it in 10 days at the same place will be different, if we want or not. Or so anyway, the record has also another aspect of reflecting on the materiality of film, because each track is made as a sound for a film, but without the image. So actually each track, like for example, one is teenage girls drumming in the middle of Shanghai as a kind of like resisting urbanization, kind of creating like a stop in the running hectic of Shanghai. And so on the record, you hear this like a bit as an irritation, but also like to create a sort of awareness. And it's a sound that maybe it's not immediately to be connected to like drumming, but once you hear, once somebody connects it to it, you immediately have this image. So I'm kind of interested in what is left out and what the imagination adds to the material that, let's say, me as the one who made the record puts in there, and then what happens to all of you if you listen to these sounds. Did I space off? Maybe that's time for questions. Thanks for your attention.
So I'm going to do the tricky part of stringing together some of the key points made. And at any point, if you have questions or comments or doubts, please raise your hands and introduce yourselves to us. So I was very conscious when thinking, first of all, of how to put together a panel of artists from an exhibition that has, as we said, over 50 practices, right? And this is just one possible arc of common strategies that are used by artists within shadow scenes. And here, I was quite, I felt that the optimism of bringing together these four artists has been sustained in the modes that this whole aspect of the, like as Liz was saying, also to investigate the anatomy of the room. So when you have this abandoned hotel room with a cinema running downstairs, how do you re-explore the anatomy of that room and fill it once again with possible stories, with new ways of approaching the conditions of viewing, perception, changing the time scale within a specific room that has a troubled history? How does that happen? And so one of the strategies seems to be of looking at an archival image and reanimating it, as Alexandra was saying, looking at how film itself can become a corruptive, contaminated substance within an ecology, how nature can become a photosensitive plate, as she brought up, or with Lucy, of how a film that is recorded can once again be turned into a blank space, as a blind spot, as something that disappears and can be seen only as that, as a negative, right? So you have a film projection on a wall which has two components, and yet you can never see the full image because that image has partly turned into sculpture. So also how to block space and how to create space, how to create depth within this exhibition through film. Also, I felt with the second presentations of how intimacy and physicality are carried across through practices of photography, as well as through the use of sound in place of image. And often we remember cinema through sound, right? We remember soundtracks, we remember dialogues, but we often forget what image was on the screen. And that also happens with history. We often remember the commentaries, the headlines, but we forget what the image was. And in some ways, I felt that that's also what came across in Susanna's space sounds, where you go from the natural sounds of birds to this kind of drumming, to extraterrestrial sounds, or to the sound of a frog that seems to be like coming from a spaceship. And so there's a lot of productive confusion that is created in these kind of details of an acoustic imagery that is created in one of the other rooms of the Rio. So one of the things for us for this exhibition was to actually imagine this building in itself as a kind of meta film, as a way in which each room is a scene of one film. So it's not simply an exhibition, but it's an architecture in which every room has a character of its own and is telling you this one entire story, which of course on the seventh floor ends with a soundtrack that tells you what's happening across the city horizon once again as a possible storyline that you hear in headphones. So this again was my way of also making a summary of these particular presentations. If you have questions that are specifically targeted to any of the artists, we'd be also happy to take them now, or I can continue with specific questions to them as well. Venika, do you want to say something?
I was just wondering, I mean, this was something I should have been wondering before, but I was too busy with the exhibition to think about it. But listening to all our international artists talking, I was wondering when you were invited to participate at Shadow Scenes, and when you were thinking about what work you were going to present, you know, what kind of went through your minds, or what sort of helped you decide what you were going to, was it obviously there was a concept note, so that was kind of a guiding factor, I guess. But I was just wondering, over and above that, you know, what kind of thought processes went through it? Because I presume that none of you had been to Sri Lanka before. You were just going on what Natasha was telling you, so you had no kind of real sense of what you were coming into.
Yeah, is this working? Yeah, I think that's a good question. So when I was invited to participate in the show, I was first a bit worried that I was kind of expected to come here and spend maybe a month here and then react to a Sri Lankan context, which I always think the only thing I would be able to do is something very anecdotal, of course, because I'm not from here. You know, even if you stay a month, you always have a look of a tourist or of a kind of external person. So somehow I think the only possibility I had is kind of, you know, not to try to comment on like Sri Lanka or the context of Sri Lanka or so, but kind of maybe kind of contribute a story, like a narrative in one of the rooms, which maybe resonates with certain things that are happening or so. But from my experience or my perspective, so not trying to, yeah, you know what I mean, kind of, yeah, I think. Otherwise, I didn't want to make something anecdotal about something that I don't really know, you know, and so.
But maybe what was interesting was also that during the time that I was working alongside you, Manika, on the exhibition, these conversations on this particular film factory, this Aqua production, that was contaminating the German landscape at the time of, also as a kind of sign of war in some way, became completely linked with what we were trying to do here also, of trying to think about how around this cinema the landscape is rapidly transforming. And I just found that this factory contaminating the landscape with its key component, with the key silver component, that then itself becomes a photograph, was very linked to our efforts. And that's sort of how, through a mutual conversation, we decided that this was a good occasion for Alexandra to launch her new film, The Silver Lake, here at Shadow Scenes.
Thanks. Is it on? Yeah, kind of on. Okay. Can you hear me? Yeah. Okay. I think it's an interesting question because I think the only option that I had was to respond to the cinema rather than this particular cinema and this particular place and the hotel also. So I think that to respond to cinema, like, I understand what cinema is. I understand the mechanism, I understand the projection, and I understand that content comes into a cinema from all over the world, and it is kind of usually treated immaterially, that it lands, it plays, it leaves, and it continues a kind of tour. And I think that coming here and making this exhibition is interesting because it brings up these different tensions of which exact film, which exact location, what that means and what that implies. So for me, it's been a kind of unfolding process of seeing specifically this cinema and specifically this context. So that's something more that I take away with me now, but I think it's an interesting occurrence.
And actually, I have a question for you, Lucy. But what I found very relevant to the approach that you've charted out is when you said that specific works of yours, such as The Margin of July, travel and are set up in actually sometimes very different ways from one exhibition to the next, and that you see that as well as a story for the work itself. And of course, then that gives me then the curiosity to ask what you think might happen next, because what we'll do is melt down that sculpture, which is in the doorway of the Rio, which has the film negatives within it, and it would then travel to the next environment, right? Do you take with you some of these physical memories of how you set up in each space, and do they affect the decisions, the kind of choreography in the next setup of the sculpture and the projection as well?
Yeah, I mean, I try to use it as a kind of conceptual or critical tool a little, rather than a visual development, although there are visual things. If you punch out the hole in a film, it looks different. But I think that unless I have a very particular invitation to use this work again, that it's going to kind of just sit in kind of latent until there's something that I feel I can add if by showing it again. So it's not that I want to constantly revisit these things, but I am interested in trying to use the development of the work as a kind of critical device that acknowledges the past of the work also.
Listen, do you want to say something about the choice of your proposal? Because you could have gone in different directions, and you were thinking about also once again visiting a personal archive, but that it's of your family, or if it's more locally specific. And it seems that what you chose instead was to use the technique of light and shadow and the inversion of the image itself as a way to comment on the location of the Rio, on its history, and again on moving from analog to digital within the moving image itself.
So my idea to work with this ancient idea of the camera obscura kind of derived from my first visit to Rio itself, when I visited the hostel, because the hotel complex was never opened. I have never seen it before, so from what I was told, it was closed up. There are a few people living in there, but I think living around and living in Colombo, I never had access to it. So for me, what was definitely interesting is the juxtaposition, what happens inside that space, which is the Rio Hotel, which I said already is kind to me like a time capsule. I walk in there and I feel like, okay, it has been closed up for 35 years, and that is how it feels. But when I look outside, it's rapidly changing. The view out of a window is something very, very interesting for me. It's something which triggers a lot of memories for me. So I felt that when we talk about photography, when we talk about film, it is always the question of how do we perceive reality? Is it really reality what we are seeing when we see a photograph and we see a film? Do we really understand? Or is it just my own reality? So I always question these realities, because I believe it is very subjective what I'm doing. In this matter, again, the way I'm hanging the cloth, the way I'm putting the pinhole, the way which room I'm choosing will again very much reflect on what the visitor or the viewer or the reader or whoever is going to see it, is going to perceive it. So I have chosen to do this. And for me, this kind of room, because it was above the cinema, had to have a link to it as well. And for me, then later on, it was very, very interesting how it evolved. So I had a structure. I had kind of a backbone to what I wanted to do. But actually, the work started once I moved with all my tools inside that room, and I started dusting these, I don't know, 40-year-old walls there, which have never been touched by anybody, because even the hotel was not running for a long time, I think 4 years or somewhat. And it started when I, while now dusting these walls, scraping down all that all that history from these walls, and then hearing the hum of the cinema, which is now, of course, screening different films than Sound of Music. And so this is when this is when it kind of evolved into this work, the final work, which is now hanging there. So for me, it was, yeah, the temporal kind of space which I've entered there. For me, it was very, very important. That's why I'm saying it's site-specific. I don't think I can take this work somewhere else because it kind of works there. I might evolve it into something else depending on another space where I'm going. But yeah, so I had this structural backbone to it, knowing what I wanted to do. But it really, really, for my process as an artist working there, it helped me to be inside that capsule and hearing, like, I always try to imagine how it would have been when somebody was sleeping in that room and hearing that hum of these musical films.
Susanna, I feel like our conversation has got together quite intuitively. It's a sort of ongoing, one of the many ongoing practices that I've been felt close to in Berlin. And it was when I heard this record of Susanna's called Space Sounds in a bookstore in Berlin, and realized how significant that would be for what we were doing here in Colombo. So somehow I have to take responsibility, definitely, for part of this, for the kind of selection of this particular work and the happy coincidence that it was produced after a long time while we were setting up for our show here. And also to pair it with this work, My Physicality, which has this blue screen on a kind of trolley. And we got the trolley from PETA. So you have the blue screen very precariously placed on a kind of luggage trolley from PETA. And it, again, I felt the blue screen says so much about the possibilities that one can project, the fiction that one can project, be anywhere from somewhere in cinema. But if there's anything else that you'd like to add to that.
No, you're way better with words. I mean, that's clear.
Well, what do you think about it now that you've seen the entire exhibition as well?
I mean, what, in a way, I'm just like happy that I could experience and see the whole exhibition, also my work, but like how it, let's say, develops in the space. Because what's actually funny is that when you go through these rooms, and a lot of them are really super similar, it's a little bit like, you know, film frame after. So in like each frame, there's something else happening, which is like a brrrr of the... So I like that the architecture also has this simplicity of going one after another. And, you know, I still mix up the levels. I still don't know that I need to go to the fifth floor when I'm on the third. And so I like this, how it really is in the architecture, in these stones where the grass is growing and where the water is dripping. So this, yeah, maybe that's what I can add to.
We do have a lot of the other artists in the show who are also in this room, who might be very quiet right now. But if there's anything that you all want to say, that would be very welcome. Because as I said, we have such a dynamic range of practices within Shadow Scenes. We have a hand-drawn map from Slave Island, which recollects through the process of drawing so many of the lost fragments of this neighborhood. We have minimalist and symbolic work, which comes, I'm not going to say names because that's maybe embarrassing, but we have just an entire range. We have all of these works that are very specifically locating themselves within the textures of the wall, hanging in a way that they also bring a check on you, whether you're going to be disturbed or whether you're going to be seduced. And I feel those are all the qualities that all of these moving image works as well share, but those within other mediums. So is anything that any of you sitting here from our artists want to say as well would be great. Quietness. There's a question at the back.
Thank you. Hi, I'd just like to put this out for the whole panel. How important is it to all of you, or any one of you who wants to answer, how important is it for your artwork to reach a wider scope than, say, a certain circle of people who may be interested in art all the time? I'm thinking of, you know, more like the public that's walking on the road. How important is it for someone like them to come in and understand your work? And how do you navigate the tensions between, you know, it being a very highly conceptualized piece of art and being able to translate or get that across to a more, let's say, a more non-arts oriented public? How do you sort of navigate those tensions?
I think that's a super good question and something that's important for me, or like when I develop a work, like for example, some of the tracks on the record. One track was made for a gallery space that had like a lot of birds on its roof. So I made like the soundtrack of that not existing film for the space. So I put the bird sound into the space. And actually my favorite compliment was that the electrician who had to finish something in the space in the morning was coming back to me saying like, hey, we need to do something. There's like a bird trapped in a gallery. We need to find a bird. So I like if, you know, that's why I'm so interested in the senses or in the physicality. I think like art or whatever, poetry as well, need to speak to everybody, not like to people who have a certain bank account or a certain education level. I don't know if that is exactly what you wanted to say, but I just answer like that. So somebody else?
I kind of feel, because I mean, as the people who are practicing inside that space, I mean, first of all, we have to realize from very basic, we are not in a gallery space, and we have certain obstacles here which we'll have to face, but we also have a really beautiful canvas to work on. What I have been experiencing with this exhibition is we have 41 works which kind of really, for myself, beautifully work together. They tell the story of this space, and there are some artists who kind of, like our international artists, who saw it more from kind of a viewpoint, okay, I have, like what Lucy said, there's a cinema, so I have to see the cinema itself, other than like going specifically into what Rio is and someone. That adds something which is really interesting, for example, to somebody else who has been inside the space and working with the space itself and seeing it and experiencing it. And I think through this kind of selection of artists and work, it becomes also, and see it, because it's a little bit of a potpourri, but still there is, I think, a story for everybody in there to discover. There might be works which are speaking more to you than other works, but seeing them all together, and this is, I think, also part of what we call a group exhibition, is the interesting part of it. It doesn't really aim for being something which should be in a gallery. It works with the space. Each work there works with the space itself, with the outline of what we have there. And it's now upon the one who comes there to discover that. I mean, we as artists will just give something, but we can only like say, okay, now, and welcome you and invite you to discover it. That's what we're trying to do.
Um, I also just do feel that just to round up on this particular question, with every kind of exhibition situation, one attempts to negotiate with this question of the audience, and especially when it comes to the visual arts, which is not necessarily a popular contemporary art, not necessarily one of the most popular mediums. We had the PETA interchange, and of course everybody wanted to dance and move, and overnight there was an amazing huge audience. But that's not always the case for the contemporary arts. And so there's a very different kind of level of reflection, engagement that happens in what we do in contemporary art. And often when there is a demand for this kind of level of popularity, for say 6,000, 7,000, 10,000 people to walk through an art exhibition, that pressure can also reduce the quality and the intention of the work itself. And so I would just point that out, that we're actually very lucky to be at the Rio complex, and every time you tell a tuk-tuk driver that, you know, there is Rio Hotel and there's a big exhibition here, of course I secretly hope that they'll walk in. But that may not be the case always, but that's really what we are aiming for. And yet to not reduce the level of focus and sophistication, reflection that these works bring in each example that is currently present in the building. There's a question at the back.
Yeah, thank you very much for this very interesting talk. We are actually not artists taking part, but we are architects that came for the building. So we are particularly interested in the building and seeing it at work at this exhibition. And it's what's interesting about your talk is also that most of you reference the cinema, but hardly anyone mentioned the hotel. And I think choosing these hotel rooms is a kind of genius act for an exhibition, because it contains two very strong provocations. One is that you actually, if you want it or not, you produced art for hotel rooms. Yeah, so you do hotel room art in that particular instance. Yeah, and that's kind of funny and interesting and intriguing, because I guess none of you would ever make hotel room art. Yeah. So the program of the hotel is very interesting in that regard, and its continuous presence in that. That is not a kind of a dead artifact with kind of neutral rooms, but these are hotel rooms. Mm-hmm. And the follow-up question on that would be that, of course, there is no tourists at the moment in these hotel rooms. So actually your art takes over the role as the tourist, yeah, visiting these places. So it's also like, yeah, I think that's also kind of interesting, this question. Like, what's your, Alexandra said, okay, you're not gonna be site-specific because you only have the chance to do some kind of anecdote about it. But that's also the interesting problematic, yeah, when you take not only the cinema seriously, but also the program of the hotel seriously, with its continuous presence.
I think that's a great question, and personally, for Menega and I, we were very conscious of how to create this exhibition. As I said, really dealing with this aspect of it being a hotel and a cinema. It's both. Because if you even notice minute details, like the way the room number is placed on top of each room, and the way the floor plan is made, it's the floor plan, it looks like it's a fire exit sign. You know, it really tells you, follow that route. If you want to not go to emergency, then you follow this route and don't jump around too much. And each room is named as, you know, 102, 103, each floor. It's really following that practical logic of being in a hotel room. And this is also why when we were installing, we were very conscious of the intimacy. How close are you to a drawing? How close are you to the corner of a sculpture that is looking at you from a distance? How close are you to an abstract work which is looking at the psyche of the city? How close are you to sacks of sand which are kind of turning into a stupa, which is a bit of a militaristic one in this case? Or how close are you to this room, which has this huge cloth painting? And that cloth painting, I was so I had so much of a nightmare thinking, is it going to fit on these hotel walls? So we've really dealt with scale, very conscious about hearing the sounds from one room to the other, really thinking about nightmares and memories and dreams that play out when you are on the bed of a hotel, and how some of the drawings really from some of our younger artists from Jaffna really could be those nightmares that you might have from living in Sri Lanka in that time. So that's, I think, definitely a foundation of the exhibition. It's just the transfer of that logic of cinema also back into the hotel. It's both ways playing out in this show.
Can I make a comment? Is there time? Yeah. Just regarding Ruth's question or comment on the audience engaging with the exhibition, I find it very interesting that the Rio now, as was mentioned, I think, by one of the panelists, it doesn't screen films like Sound of Music or South Pacific. I mean, it's all like adult movies that are screened there. So again, there's a particular crowd that's always coming into the cinema to watch those films. And when we were walking around and preparing, they were really embarrassed to see us looking at them. But I think maybe some of the artists got the opportunity to engage with the inhabitants and the residents of Slave Island as part of their projects. And as I was one of them, I actually invited these people to come into the cinema. And I had some interesting responses. Like one response was they were willing to come in before the exhibition and be perhaps part of whatever we were doing, but they didn't want to come in during the exhibition, and they asked us to send them the footage or the information or whatever. So, I mean, I was personally, I would have loved for everybody who lives in that area to actually know what's going on. I think most of them don't even realize, and to engage with the exhibition, but perhaps there's like a stigma associated with walking into that space as well. So lots of contradictions, like people want to go into the cinema to watch the films, but they don't want to be caught by us watching them there. So then they want to avoid us, or they don't want to even go because people will immediately associate them with what else is going on in the cinema. So it's a rather complex space, and that's quite interesting. Yeah.
Thanks for that, Debbie. For anyone who is still to visit the show, Debbie is one of the participants and has reflected on the history of this site through a short film with a filmmaker, Danushka Gunatilake. Is there anyone else? We are running out of time. So if there are no more questions, then we could also close and hope very much that you will visit the exhibition, which is on until the 30th of August.
It's not really a question, it's just a comment. We took the owner of this the building round the exhibition yesterday, and I think he was quite amazed at the potential of it, in a way. He was very taken by the exhibition, wanted to buy one of the works, and I think he just didn't realize the potential of that building, you know, because they kind of neglected it and just left it. So hopefully maybe, you know, that could be revitalized in some way as an art space.
Yeah, just to say that the Rio Hotel and Cinema used to be, as per the owner and the son of Mr. Navratnam, the son of the person who started the cinema and hotel, did share with us how it used to be very much a community site, very much at the center of the dynamics of the neighborhood. And his father, Mr. Navratnam, was someone who built school buildings, gave his car for weddings, you know, was really a social figure, was a patron for the local football club. You know, this was, the Rio in that sense, was part of a community spirit before the incident of Black July. And in some way, we built a kind of temporary community of artists and cultural workers within the building once again. And that was also something that was an intention of how to bring it back into an association of not simply that was more positive, but much more community oriented and much more at the center of activity rather than of destruction and quietness. So I think I'll close with that session, and so that the rest of the day can proceed. Thank you very much, all of our artists participating and those in the audience. We hope you continue to enjoy the festival, and have a good day.